Can you hear me well? So in this last talk, I will zoom into from the larger scale to one of the processes developing on regional or even mesoscale processes contributing to the eutrophication and water management, namely the algae blooms. My name is Inga Koszalka. I'm associated professor lecturer at the Department of Meteorology here. My expertise is in physical oceanography, modeling, data analysis. I started my working here 2 years ago, just a few months before the outbreak of the pandemic. And I have to say, I haven't had many possibilities to give talks in this room, but I'm very happy that we are back on the schedule. And this work is a collaboration with my colleague Agnes Carson from DEEP. And we are both Baltic Sea fellows, and this is how we met. And then we decided to combine our forces and expertises to address one of the big questions of coastal oceanography. And this is the question of algae blooms. So algae, plankton, phytoplankton blooms are frequent in the summer. They create these surface accumulations. Some of them, and I will focus on cyanobacterial blooms, these, for example, nodularia species, they have negative impacts on aesthetic values of the sea. They limit access to the oxygen, and they can be toxic to human and marine life. For example, in 2018, there was a big bloom triggered by a marine heat wave that caused Polish health authorities to close 50 beaches in the southern Baltic, and the same event disrupted the brackish waterworks in Gotland, so where the fresh water, drinking water is produced from the seawater, and where this algae can decrease the quality and hinder the water supplies. And also the algae produce organic matter that sedimentates and can contribute to the eutrophication anoxia. However, they're also an important component of the food web, so it's not just simple, they're not just bad guys, but the impact of algae is much more complicated. But they're classified as environmental hazard, for example, by ISA. They're also mentioned in the Sustainable Development Goals 14, life below water, and 6, the clear water. What is apparent, and this is what we see from the satellite observations, is that the algae, and in particular cyanobacteria, are impacted by the ocean current, so they drift in the ocean. And we see these striking turbulent current features on the algae accumulations. Also, it has been noted that they are more frequent in warm waters, so these marine heat waves trigger strong algae blooms. So the physical factors are very important in regulating the growth of the algae. So these facts are also used to in the monitoring and early warning systems. And examples are, maybe you know, algae situation produced by SMHI. And there is a service at the Copernicus Environmental Marine Services that combines the model drift and the satellite pictures to estimate the drift of algae in the next 3 days. However, we do not really have a reliable forecast systems for the algae blooms. And why is that? There are two main challenges on the both sides, physical, biological. That's a small scale currents in the Baltic Sea of the order of a few hundred meters, 1 kilometer, so comparable and smaller than the resolution of the operational models used to predict the sea state. And nonlinear turbulent processes steering and straining the algae blooms. And then there is a complexity of the biogeochemical models. So this is what Monica already introduced us in her talk in the beginning. So the complexity of the biogeochemical processes and the different biological processes, like for example, if small zooplankton can eat the big algae. So this is probably just one of the very, very many important aspects to consider. And when we build these models, we have complex models with many variables and coefficients, and these are very difficult to constrain with the available data. So these are the challenges. So let's look a little bit in this phenomenon to give a foundation what we want to do. So we talk about drift, and the basic assumption assumption is that we can represent any accumulation, like surface accumulation of algae, so-called patch, by a cloud of particles. So these particles will be strained and by the underlying currents, and these particles. So the motion statistics on these particles can be used to infer the fate of the patches. So when I will say drifting, we also call it Lagrangian. So Lagrangian frame, the moving frame when we study the motion of the water, either deploying real instruments and looking how they drift in time, or doing the same in the ocean models, deploying numerical particles and see how they move through the region in time. And trajectory refers to the series of the positions of particle drifter. So this, I will refer to these notions. So using that fact that we can use particles to represent algae patches, and that we see from the satellite pictures that the currents steer the distribution and concentration of the algae. So this led us to conceptualize this project to combine my expertise in ocean modeling and Lagrangian modeling and data analysis, and Agnes' knowledge of ecosystem, marine ecosystem in the Baltic, in particular the algae in that context. So we got founded a project that's the Bolin Center Climate Research Spring Call, and our so this was the instruments were founded by this, the surface drifters that I will talk about, and then our contribution, our work, and the infrastructure is provided by the Baltic Sea Center for those programs. So the idea is that we use the numerical Lagrangian models and the surface drifter observations, compare them, and develop parameterizations, representation of the physical processes that are not well represented by the models, and then develop Lagrangian models for algae. So plant a little ecosystem in each of the drifters, simulating drifters, and then we can interpolate the concentrations from many particles on the grid, and then compare to the satellite observations. So I will talk mostly about this first ongoing project, observational. The observations, surface drifters observations, are provided by these Carter Smart platforms. They are specially developed to study the surface processes. Unlike the standard drifters that drift 15 meters below the water, these are dragged at 40 centimeters depth. So this is more or less like the algae surface accumulation lives in this depths. And they are relatively cheap and biodegradable, the plastic parts, and they are tracked, satellite tracked by the Global Star system, 15 down to 5 minute frequency. So we got six of these instruments, and so the deployments were guided by the simulations. And the first deployments happened just like over a month ago in August from Electra during the cocktail expedition. There were very strong wind. We got like 9 Beaufort's scale at the end of the day, which shaked the cocktail a little bit. But in the result, the drifters sampled a very strong wind drift that after about a week, they stranded by the coast, and then we recovered them, and then they will be deployed next week in the lands of the deep. So I will have a drift measurements for the drift different situations, so in the coastal region and then further into the sea. But we are focusing on this region, Western Gotland Basin, and on coastal processes. So here are some snapshots from the deployment. Me with drifters, so that's quite easy job. And then this pictures from the recovery with my colleagues from MISO. Actually, the Global Star GPS tracking was super accurate. It was very easy to find them along the Swedish coast. So now they are ready to. They are on Electra, and will go next week to their next mission. So here, how the dashboard looks like with the drifters deployed in 2 triplets. So here we went with Electra. So we deployed 2 closer to the coast and 2 a little bit further. And what you can see is this, that they actually travel very close to one another and for a long time. And this is because of this strong wind drift. And now I will try to, play a little movie. 2 minutes, okay. All right, so these are the drifters superimposed on the SMHI current model simulations. So what you see is that they follow the model very nicely, which is very encouraging. So that means that the models can be used to do the simulations of drift. So the model validation is ongoing, will be ongoing, and I will use some methods that I already talked about 1 year ago on Zoom. So I will not stay there, but explain to you a little bit how we are going to do with the biology as a next step. So every of the drifters can be thought as a patch containing some concentration of phytoplankton, zooplankton nutrients. And already during my PhD, I studied how this kind of model can be implemented on the particles that are then drifting in ocean model currents. So phytoplankton is changing in time, and this is expression for the u velocity of the model moving phytoplankton. And then it's a part of the extracted bit of the model I use in my PhD, but you can see that it has dependent on the nutrient and zooplankton grazing and zooplankton mortality. And in time, the particle is traveling from different nutrient concentrations, and phytoplankton and zooplankton is growing, and I will connect to the talk of John here. So these functions, Holling functions that he talked about, they're actually shown here. So the linear dependence of the grazer on the food, but we have also the type 2, which is the one with the linear functions in the denominator and type 3 quadratic. And in the dependence that the saturation coefficients that regulate the shape of the function and then the growth of the phytoplankton determines the growth of the phytoplankton in response. So in the nonlinear systems theory, we study actually how these different shapes impact the fate of the variables. And if you are interested in that, I lead a PhD course on in advanced mathematics. So you can learn more about this if you want. So then these particles are interpolated on the grid, and then they can be compared to the satellite pictures model concentrations using spectral methods and some first attempts done by my student assistant of this. So the spectral methods measure the amount of variation in inverse scale. So for example, this will have a lot of variations on larger scales. These red on smaller scales, so these will appear more smooth than these ones. And there's a lot of noise and small scales in the pictures, but we actually see some signs that we can actually extract the signal from the noise. So the plan would be to design a very simple model with a temperature instead of nutrients and fit this to the satellite pictures. So it was end. I will just play a movie done by another student of mine from Germany showing concentrations of particles in the whole Baltic Sea. So that's the simulation.
So thank you, Inga. So we can expect soon from SMHI and up where we get hourly observations
exactly.
And forecasts of bathing quality in every bay in the Baltic.
Yeah.
So that's
this
cool.
This is the goal for the next year.
Okay.
Yeah, but that's actually the
follow-up.
Yeah,
I'm not kidding. No, I'm expecting that. Yes, that's for sure. Thank you. Thank you.